Thank you.
Thank you.
Hal, you okay, sit up here?
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Court of Appeals of Georgia is now in session. Honorable Anne Elizabeth Barnes presiding.
Welcome, everyone. I understand we have a student arguing today.
Yes. The first case on the calendar, Judge, is A22A0508. Edward E. Williams versus DeKalb County et al. And Mr. Thomas Birch is going to introduce our law student who's going to argue today. Mr. Birch.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. I'm Thomas Birch from the University of Georgia on behalf of Dr. Ed Williams. I have two students I'd like to introduce to help on the case, Mr. Dylan Baldwin and Ms. Roy Dagenbohr. Today, Ms. Dagenbohr will be presenting argument on our behalf, and I'll be sitting at the council table. Thank you, Your Honor.
So only one student will be arguing?
That's correct.
Okay.
And if you would, you can either take your mask off before you argue or just point it right at the microphone and speak clearly. Okay. Thank you.
May it please the court. My name is Roy Nydeo, and alongside Professor Birch and my co-student counsel, Dylan Malden, I represent Dr. Edward Williams. This case is about Dr. Williams, a DeKalb County taxpayer, trying to hold his county commissioners accountable for giving themselves a 60% pay increase without adequate public notice and pursuant to a statute that the Georgia General Assembly did not have the constitutional authority to pass. This court should reverse the trial court's rulings and hold that Dr. Williams's claims, and reverse the trial court's rulings for two reasons. First, Dr. Williams does have taxpayer standing to challenge this unlawful disbursement of public funds. And second, because Dr. Williams's complaint states a valid Open Meetings Act violation, as the Supreme Court already held last time on the board member's motion to dismiss. To briefly summarize the procedural posture of this case, Dr. Williams filed claims against the CEO and the Board of Commissioners over 3 years ago. Originally, the trial court dismissed his claims, and on appeal, the Supreme Court reversed in part, holding first that Dr. Williams does have generally taxpayer standing to bring his claims against the CEO for an injunction, so long as the CEO does have the authority to stop those payments, and holding that Dr. Williams' complaint does allege an Open Meetings Act violation.
Counsel, once the commission passed the pay raise, how did CEO Thurman have the authority to stop the payments being made?
Your Honor, on remand, the CEO admitted that he does have the enforcement authority over the ordinance. And so he admitted that in Dr. Williams' request for admission and on his partial motion for summary judgment on the standing issue in their response to his statement of undisputed material facts. The question that the Supreme Court sent back was whether the CEO had the authority to stop the payments should he be enjoined to do so. And on that, we have that admission. But despite that, the trial court still held that he doesn't have standing, despite the fact that was the one thing the Supreme Court said was missing from that taxpayer standing analysis. It held so on grounds that the Supreme Court already reversed last time. First, it held that he somehow has to show a particularized injury, despite the fact that last time the Supreme Court acknowledged that Dr. Williams doesn't have an injury here, and under Georgia's taxpayer standing doctrine, plaintiffs who proceed challenging constitutional challenges like Dr. Williams don't need to show any sort of injury. He's challenging an unlawful disbursement of public funds, and that's how the doctrine is developed.
So second, does he have an injury, or does he not have an injury?
No, Your Honor, Dr. Williams doesn't need to present an injury under that standing doctrine. So with taxpayer standing, both there and on the Open Meetings Act claims, we give citizens like Dr. Williams the right to bring these claims because it's a general injury to the public, not a particularized injury as to him or his conduct.
But if we determine that he does have an injury, he does need that, did he have a particularized injury or not?
Your Honor, as a taxpayer, I would presume that he would. I'm not sure exactly that we have that at this stage of the pleadings. What we do have is that question back from the Supreme Court on the motion to dismiss, where they said to remand for more fact-finding on that one question. So they held, as a taxpayer in Georgia, he generally has standing because taxpayer standing only requires on that unlawful disbursement of public funds that he generally show that. And in order to enjoin the CEO, show that the CEO actually does have the power to stop that unlawful disbursement that Dr. Williams is challenging.
But on the remand, wasn't the injury, silence cell phones, please. Wasn't the injury that was set forth that he just lost trust and faith that they would be able to follow the law? Isn't that the only thing that he articulated was his injury?
Your Honor, yes, but again, that doesn't matter because last time this case was before the Supreme Court, it acknowledged that Dr. Williams doesn't have an injury, but that he doesn't need one, neither for the first issue here on standing or for the Open Meetings Act claims. It acknowledged that, and he never claimed one. And but besides that, because the law doesn't require him to show one. And
does the law require a particularized showing of injury to him specifically, or just all the taxpayers? Because wouldn't logically all the taxpayers in DeKalb County pay more taxes because the commissioners are being paid 60% more, and there's several of them, and if you spread it out, even if it's a few pennies, they're going to be paying more taxes, logically, wouldn't you think?
Yes, Your Honor, that's precisely why Georgia's taxpayer standing doctrine doesn't require any sort of particularized injury as to Dr. Williams himself. It's presumed that that is within that taxpayer standing doctrine. And that's why the Supreme Court held that as a citizen and taxpayer of DeKalb County, he generally has standing and only set back the question of whether the CEO actually has the authority to stop the payments should he be enjoined. Because it concluded that Dr. Williams is seeking injunctive relief, challenging the constitutionality of the salary statute and ordinance. And so in order to do that, it held that all he has to do is show that he has taxpayer standing. And that one question of whether the CEO could actually address that was what they sent back. So the trial court ignored that and ignored the fact that that injury question was already addressed. It also ignored the fact that the Supreme Court already dismissed Dr. Williams' claims for declaratory relief and held that in order to get to the constitutional issue, to get to the merits, that he needs both injunctive relief and declaratory relief. Despite the fact that last time this was before the Supreme Court dismissed his declaratory relief claim and remanded the injunctive relief claim on that constitutional question. And so to somehow say now that despite the fact that the Supreme Court addressed this last time, that he has to present a declaratory relief claim is inconsistent with the Supreme Court's dismissal of that claim and remand of the injunctive relief claim on the constitutional issue. And the only case there is Sexual Offender Registration Review Board versus Burzett, which is the case that the trial court cited for that finding last time, that the Supreme Court reversed and addressed on appeal. So Burzett doesn't apply here, and Dr. Williams doesn't need a declaratory relief claim to seek injunctive relief. Additionally, the trial court held that the salary ordinance was lawful, and that Dr. Williams has to present that it is unlawful before he can proceed, and then concluded that he doesn't have standing. But that's inconsistent with the fact that the Supreme Court remanded to the trial court first to answer the question of standing before getting into any of the merits-based claims at all. And even if the trial court wanted to address part of the merits of, or address the merits as part of standing, it failed to address all of his claims on the merits and only addressed one of his four claims. And so despite the fact that the Supreme Court told the trial court to address standing before the merits, it failed to do so and ignored three of his claims. And this court should also reverse for that reason. The CEO also supports the trial court's rulings on alternative grounds. First, stating that Dr. Williams is only seeking declaratory relief and not injunctive relief, despite the fact that it's clear in his complaint that he's seeking injunctive relief, and also despite the fact that the Supreme Court already dismissed those declaratory relief claims. And Dr. Williams acknowledges that. He's only seeking injunctive relief, challenging the constitutionality of that statute. And to say otherwise would look beyond the complaint and characterize an injunctive relief claim as declaratory relief where that claim was already dismissed. Additionally, they argue that the constitutionality claim itself was thrown out last time by the Supreme Court, despite the fact the court actually only remanded that question with the when they remanded the injunction, they stated that he is challenging allegedly unconstitutional acts, and an injunctive relief was for challenging the constitutionality of that statute in addition to his other merits-based claims. And so on standing, the trial court read in requirements that the Supreme Court had already dismissed last time and added in erroneous, and made that erroneous conclusion, and this court should reverse that and hold that Dr. Williams does have standing generally as a taxpayer, given the admission that the CEO does have that authority. Now, moving on to Dr. Williams' Open Meetings Act claims. Last time this case was before the Supreme Court, it was on the board member's motion to dismiss. On that issue, the Supreme Court held that Dr. Williams' complaint, if proven true, established clear violations of the Open Meetings Act. On remand, for some reason, on the board member's motion for judgment of pleadings, which is the exact same standard as a motion to dismiss, the trial court still granted that motion and dismissed his claim. But the complaint hasn't changed at all, and Dr. Williams is alleging the exact same Open Meetings Act violations that he has since the beginning of this case. First, the board members called the January 19th meeting with less than 24 hours notice. Second, that they called that meeting and at that meeting voted and discussed the salary increase and voted to advertise the increase in the county's legal organ without recording any minutes or the vote that was taken at the meeting. Third, that they called the February 27th meeting with the intention of discussing the salary ordinance without including it on the agenda. And third, the fact that they expected to raise that issue and failed to actually include it on the agenda despite that expectation. And so despite the fact Dr. Williams' complaint and his claims with regard to the Open Meetings Act have remained exactly the same since the last time that this case was before the Supreme Court, the trial court still erroneously granted the motion for judgment of pleadings on that issue when the Supreme Court already found these allegations, if proven true, do establish a clear violation of the Open Meetings Act. And despite the fact that it's the same exact requirement, we somehow are here because his complaint got dismissed functionally the same exact way that the Supreme Court reversed it last time. And not only did they find that he alleged generally Open Meetings Act violations, they also found that he alleged that the board members acted with actual malice. So any argument that there is an immunity-based defense.
What evidence do you have to support the actual malice allegation?
Your Honor, for the actual malice allegation, the Supreme Court discussed Dr. Williams's allegations that the board members did call these meetings intentionally violating the Open Meetings Act, knowing that they were going to discuss the salary ordinance and failing to include that on the meeting agenda both times. With regard to the January 19th meeting, calling it with less than 24 hours notice and then discussing that without including it in any meeting minutes, and then knowing after advertising it three times in the county's legal organ that they were going to discuss it at the February 27th meeting, and knowingly omitting that from that meeting agenda. There were two different violations here, and he alleged that it was intentional.
Do you agree or disagree with the, as I recall in the order, which was about 34 pages, there was a factual reasoning for it being that there was a bill being passed in the General Assembly that they were monitoring, and there was no reason to put it on until that bill failed, and the timing of the failure of that bill in the General Assembly was between the time of the last publication and the meeting. Do you agree with the factual analysis of everything? everything in that order? And if so, does that give rise to support the reason for it not being perhaps done, you know, technically correctly for an open meeting? Does that make sense to you?
It does, Your Honor. Okay. So I'm not sure that I agree with all of the trial court's findings on the issue. The board members did allege the first time that this was something that they were watching the General Assembly on, and that was included in their answer the first time this case was before the trial court. And they did say that they were seeking a two-track approach to the salary increase. They were monitoring the General Assembly and pursuing this separately, but there are two distinct Open Meetings Act claims here, the January 19th meeting and the February 27th meeting. And on the stage of the pleadings that we're at, and with all those allegations before the Supreme Court last time, the court still held that Dr. Williams's complaint allegedly, or sufficiently alleged, Open Meetings Act violations on that. And so without getting into the merits, we do know that regardless of what it did say in the answer, the trial court was supposed to take Dr. Williams's allegations as true, and theirs as false.
Does the fact that Dr. Williams was present at the meeting where they discussed this and had the opportunity to stand up and address it and oppose it factor into this at all and cure any deficiencies in the open meeting violations?
No, Your Honor, it doesn't. So the Open Meetings Act, similar to the taxpayer standing issue, was enacted to prevent and protect the public generally, individuals and the public generally, from closed-door politics. And so it doesn't require any sort of particularized injury. So regardless of whether Dr. Williams was at the meeting or not, it still amounted to a violation. I'd like to reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal.
You may do so.
Thank you.
Can we wait just a minute before you come up to the table?
May it please the court. My name is Brent here, and I have the privilege today of representing the CEO of DeKalb County, Michael Thurman, in this matter. I will be arguing the first enumeration of error of the appellants. My co-counsel sitting at the table, Mr. Kendrard, represents the commissioners. He'll be presenting argument on the second and third enumerations of error. What Dr. Williams seeks without alleging sufficient facts is a declaration that the salary ordinance is illegal and should not be enforced. In essence, Dr. Williams wants the CEO to change the amounts to be paid to the county commissioners. Unfortunately for Dr. Williams, CEO Thurman doesn't have that authority. DeKalb County is a unique form of government in that the county commissioners act as the legislative branch of the government and the CEO acts as the executive. While the CEO may have the authority to sign checks to pay commissioners, he has no authority to change the amounts that the commissioners passed through a budget.
Well, counsel just said there were requests for admissions wherein it was admitted that he had the authority to do that. Is that incorrect?
What he admitted was that he had the authority to execute the laws that are passed by the commission. He does not have the authority to appropriate funds. But once those funds are appropriated by the commission, he has to write a check and pay those salaries.
He has no discretion.
He has no discretion. That's correct, John. And that's what we did admit. We admit that he has to enforce the ordinance as passed. The trial court was correct in dismissing Dr. Williams' claims for three reasons and denying the motion for partial summary judgment. One, Dr. Williams lacks taxpayer standing because he has failed to show an unlawful expenditure of public funds. Two, he lacks taxpayer standing because he hasn't shown a particularized injury. And three, because the Supreme Court has foreclosed his claims for declaratory relief, his injunctive relief claims must also fail. As to the first reason, there is no unlawful expenditure of public funds. The Supreme Court in Williams versus DeKalb County affirmed the dismissal of all claims against the CEO and remanded the case back with a small issue to be considered, and that is, does Dr. Williams have taxpayer standing to seek an injunction to prevent the CEO from enforcing the salary order? And as a part of that, To establish that taxpayer standing, Dr. Williams has to show there is an unlawful expenditure of public funds, and that he has failed to do. The court below found that he hasn't shown that the enforcement of the salary ordinance is an illegal expenditure of public funds because the ordinance was validly enacted. What Dr. Williams argues is that because the CEO failed to either sign or veto the ordinance when it was passed out of the commission, that somehow that makes it ineffective. And in doing that, he focuses on one section of the DeKalb County Organizational Act that says that within 8 days of passage of an ordinance, the CEO must either sign or veto, and except as otherwise provided, it shall not become law without his signature. If you look at the immediately preceding subsection, it says that if the CEO does not sign or veto an ordinance, it becomes law within 8 business days without his signature. That's a common feature in governmental documents. The U.S. Constitution has that provision for the president. The Georgia Constitution has that provision for the governor. The dates are a little different, but they all say they aren't signed within 70 days, they become law automatically. And again, what Dr. Williams really is requesting is that the trial court declare the salary ordinance unconstitutional. Well, those claims have already been decided by the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court has said that Dr. Williams doesn't have standing to bring those claims. So it's the law of the case that those claims are, the trial court can't address those claims. So the only claim that is left is whether or not CEO Thurman is committing an illegal act, and can the court stop him from committing that illegal act? Because that's how you issue an injunction. In short, Dr. Williams' remaining claims against the CEO are not relief that the CEO can provide. The Dr. Williams in the trial court was correct in dismissing those claims. As to the second reason, Dr. Williams has not shown any particularized injury to establish taxpayer standing. During oral argument, and Judge Hodges, as you mentioned, Dr. Williams admitted the only harm that he suffered was a loss of trust and faith in the government to follow the law. Additionally, Dr. Williams alleged in his complaint that it was DeKalb County's action harms tax rates. Judge Barnes, you were talking about the tax rates, and that over time it diverts taxpayer revenue. This is exactly the type of injury that the appellants alleged in Gaddy versus Georgia Department of Revenue, and the Supreme Court rejected that argument and found no taxpayer standing. In that case,
what were the facts of that case?
In that case, it was a tax credit. That is, that the Georgia Department of Revenue gave to taxpayers. And the appellants in that case argued that the tax credit that was provided would lower, would put a larger burden on the appellants as the taxpayers, because they would have to pay more money because they didn't take advantage of the tax credit. And what the Supreme Court said is it's purely speculative that it would actually harm the taxpayer, because there are other ways that that you could pay for that. You could reduce the budget, for example, is one of the examples they gave. And what the Supreme Court says that the shortfall that the taxpayers were alleging in that case was not a sufficient injury to allege taxpayer standing to challenge a statutory provision. And that's the only harm in this case. He admitted at the hearing he had no harm. The only harm is what he had in his complaint. And that is the harm that the appellants in Gaddy showed, and that's in a, that is not sufficient to establish taxpayer standing. Because he has failed to show any particularized harm or injury by the enforcement of the salary ordinance by Appellee Thurman, the appellant has failed to show that he has taxpayer standing to seek injunctive relief against my client. The final reason that the trial court was correct is that without the declaratory relief claims as to the constitutionality of the salary statute or any facts establishing that the enforcement of the statute is somehow illegal, Dr. Williams' injunctive relief claims must fail. In the Brissette case, the Supreme Court has held that absent a declaratory judgment claim seeking a declaration that the statute is unconstitutional, there can be no claim for injunctive relief to prevent the enforcement of that statute. Accordingly, as a matter of law, the injunctive relief claim that Dr. Williams seeks in this case is not viable. And while the appellant tries to couch this third amended complaint as something other than seeking declaratory relief, repeatedly throughout the third amended complaint, he seeks declaratory relief to declare both the salary ordinance and the salary statute is passed by the General Assembly as unconstitutional. Because there is no declaratory relief claim left, this action, any actions for declaratory or injunctive relief based on such declaratory relief must fail. Finally, the Superior Court only has authority to issue an injunction to prevent an illegal act. The salary ordinance was passed by the Commission. It became law without Appellee Thurman's signature. Under the DeKalb County Organizational Act, it is the law of DeKalb County. Since the salary ordinance has not been declared unconstitutional, there is a presumption under the law that it is constitutional. Without a constitutional challenge via a declaratory judgment claim with respect to the salary ordinance, or otherwise showing that the enforcement of the salary ordinance is somehow illegal, appellant cannot show that Appellee Thurman would be committing an illegal act that court may restrain.
But if you assume that the increase in salary was illegal, we're not assuming that, of course, but is everything you're saying, it seems, would still be the same?
If we assume that it's illegal in what sense?
That it was passed illegally, that it was passed.
Well,
if you assume everything that they said.
As an example, let's say that the salary ordinance, one example I guess could be the salary ordinance was vetoed and the commission didn't override the veto, and then my client continues to pay what the salary ordinance says. That would be illegal. I think that he would have taxpayer standing in that sense. But there's just no facts to support that. The facts are the commission passed the salary ordinance. It became law without my client's signature. My client has no discretion on whether to pay those salaries or not. And because of that,
basically, you're just arguing that he's out of the loop.
That's correct.
Even if they acted illegally.
If they acted illegally, if the ordinance was illegal in some way, I think a court could restrain my client from enforcing it. What I'm saying is there are no facts.
He hypothetically could.
Correct. A court could do that. He alleges that my client just has the authority to not enforce it at all, and I don't think my client has that authority without a court order for him to do that. With that, I'll reserve the balance of the time for my co-counsel. Thank you.
Good afternoon, may I please the honorable court, colleagues. My name is Ken Gerard. I represent the DeKalb County Board of Commissioner members in their individual capacities. It's a pleasure to be in front of you today. Let me start by saying this. I am going to address the Open Meetings Act elements of this today, primarily focused on what plaintiffs complain is primarily focused on, which is the February 27, 2018 meeting. And I want to emphasize at the outset that Dr. Williams attended the duly noticed February 27, 2018 meeting, which was open to the public. Dr. Williams personally addressed the Board of Commissioners about the salary ordinance at the February 27, 2018 meeting. Dr. Williams watched his Board of Commissioners function, watched and observed the vote, and otherwise was there because of a three-week legal advertisement indicating that this matter may in fact have been taken up that evening. That is a remarkable state of facts for us to be discussing open meetings penalties provisions.
What actually happened on January 19th?
What's that now?
You had a meeting that occurred on January the 19th at 9 a.m. It was only announced at 2 p.m. the day before. It's alleged that there was actual discussion about the salary increase, but it didn't actually end up on the record. So what actually was discussed at the meeting of January 19th, special meeting?
A variety of things were discussed. The minutes, Your Honor, are in the record. But it was mainly, I think, in fact, even the name of the retreat was a legislative retreat. And not surprisingly then, what was discussed was a variety of things that dealt with their engagement with the local delegation to the General Assembly, which is very common for boards of commissioners to do right in January, right before the session begins or when the session is ongoing. So that's what they discussed. I will also say, in anticipation of what you may ask, which is, the Supreme Court went through the January 19th meeting in excruciating detail, walked through every line of it, and actually found in their order, the Supreme Court's 2020 order indicated that the only claim that has been stated by Dr. Williams with respect to the state of the pleadings at that time was for the agenda setting requirement related to the February 27, 2018 meeting. My point simply is, the Supreme Court went through the facts of the January 19th allegations as pled by Dr. Williams and did not remand that claim. The only claim that was remanded pertained to the agenda setting requirement for the February 27th meeting. If there had been, in fact, a viable claim related to the January 19th meeting, that wouldn't have been the agenda setting requirement. It would have been the notice requirement, because that's the allegation, is that the notice was provided less than 24 hours in advance and it was not a recordation of any sort of an emergency situation on the minutes. That would have been the situation.
After the notice appeared three times in the county organ, why didn't it just go ahead and anticipate the possibility that the salary would be discussed? Why wasn't it on the agenda?
Two answers for that, Your Honor, and it's a reasonable question. Two answers for that. Number one is what we attempted to do when the case was remanded, is we attempted to provide this very granular clarification of what was going on behind, quote unquote, the scenes. And I say that in the sense of the interaction between the board members or some of the board members and the delegation. They thought there was going to be this bill that was going to affect their salary by way of a local law. And I will submit to the court that would have been the preferable way to have the local act carry the compensation, because first of all, it becomes effective quicker with the compensation statute. You have to wait an election cycle before the compensation becomes effective. So we provided that background simply to tell Judge Dempsey, the trial court, on remand, we understand the allegation that there was this intentional omission of this item off the February 27, 2018 agenda, and we understand that based upon the state of the pleadings, that the court has to accept that to be true. And to the extent that we can agree that an intentional act is an act of volitional will, yes, it was not on the agenda. We agree to that because the record reflects that it wasn't. What we've attempted to show Judge Dempsey, and by extension this court, is the why. In other words, we're not saying that Dr. Williams is wrong, at least for purposes of where we are in the pleadings. We're showing the why. Now, we admitted in our brief, you know, would the most perfect course have been to go ahead and add it on the agenda and then just withdraw it at the agenda itself or during the course of the meeting? That could have been done. But the Open Meetings Act does not require such exactitude. The reality is there was a reasonable belief that this would be handled by the local delegation, and therefore it was not required to be on the agenda. But between the time that the February 27th agenda was set and the actual meeting itself, the bill stopped.
When was the meeting set and when was the bill stopped?
Your Honor, I believe the agenda for the meeting was set around February 20th is what I believe, and sometime after that is when DeKalb County received word that the bill had stalled.
Well, why not amend the agenda at that point?
With respect, Your Honor, I'm not sure whether DeKalb County allows at post-publication but pre-meeting amendments to their agenda, if you will. And so they had to do it at the meeting itself, which, by the way, the Open Meetings Act specifically allows. In other words, this is not like the Earth Resources case where there was actually a true technical violation, truly a technical violation of the agenda requirement. The Open Meetings Act specifically tolerates, allows agendas to be modified during the meeting itself, and even goes further to say that if you adopt the or amend the agenda during the meeting, you can take action on that item, which is what the Board of Commissioners did. I mean, that's one of the things that has been vexing from my perspective in this case, is that what DeKalb County took advantage of is in fact a specific allowance under the Open Meetings Act. I don't have to tell this court, but the Open Meetings Act was fundamentally retooled in 2012, and the General Assembly left that language in the Act. And so DeKalb County took advantage of that language, and something did become, and I know this is the linchpin, something did become necessary between the time of the published agenda having been published and the date of the meeting. And the thing that became necessary was the stalling of the local.
Well, you said it stalled, but there still could have been an opportunity. It could have been brought up again, and the General Assembly, correct? I know there's a timing issue.
No,
but it was still an opportunity that it could come up at a later date.
It was conceivable and it was possible, but you just said the thing that I was going to respond with you, Justice Brown, and that is the salary setting law that the General Assembly is very exacting with respect to the timelines. If you're going to set and use this sort of this home rule allowance to set your own salary by way of the statute, you've got to set it before qualifying begins for the next election. And that's the deadline they were up against. So you're not wrong, Your Honor. Of course, there's always a possibility that it could have been revived at the General Assembly level. But at that point, it was getting too near the deadline. By that time, they had run the three-week legal ad. And of course, that is a specific requirement under the statute. It has to be 3 weeks prior to the date that it is finally adopted. So they really couldn't deconstruct that timing. They were really caught between a rock and a hard place.
Isn't it rather unusual for a 60% salary increase to be voted by any board, commission, or anything to itself?
What
did this amount to in terms of dollars and cents per commission members? Wouldn't it be like $100,000?
No, Your Honor, and I'm not in a position to tell you what all 159 counties have done with respect to boards setting their own compensation. I will tell you, I think the swing here was between like $48,000 and $60,000 or $65,000, something along those lines. And I would also...
Was it a 60% increase?
I don't know that that's a 60%
increase. I read that it was to 90% of the salary of a DeKalb County sitting Superior Court, I guess including the supplement, which I think would be around $200,000. So if it was a 60% increase, it would be a lot of money.
Yeah, it's not
unusual.
It's not that amount of money. What I would further suggest to the court is what I'm used to saying is that a lot of times, Board of Commissioners don't enjoy setting their own salaries any more than anybody else does that has the power to do it themselves, for the very reasons that you all are asking about and for the very reasons that citizens raise as well, is it seems like it puts them between a rock and a hard place. What I'm used to, however, is that a Board of Commissioners will set their salary and then not think about it again for a decade while all the inflationary forces that affect all of us come into play. And then when they finally do take it up again and go ahead and withstand the slings and arrows to take it up again, it seems like it's a lot more, but really what it's doing is catching up with inflation, is what it's really doing. And I think that would be the case here if we were to look and break those numbers down.
What's your position on whether you think Dr. Williams has pled enough to survive the motion?
Your Honor, he has not. He has not pled enough to withstand our motion to dismiss, and Judge Dempsey, in this respect, got it exactly right. And if I could, I want to spend, if I will, enough time, but I want to say this case is controlled by official immunity. This is a case involving, if I may, a discretionary function, which was the decision to place something on the agenda. So that's a discretionary function. Of course, under official immunity analysis, that puts us into the actual malice standard. And then, of course, you have to have a demonstration of this constitutionally difficult showing of actual malice. And I'm going to read one case, and then I will sit down. And that case is, of course, Murphy versus Vagina, 282 Georgia 197. It's a Supreme Court case dated 2007, although I will tell you that the Court of Appeals used the same language in its next year's case of Selby versus Morrison. But here's what it said. If you are going to seek to impose some sort of a penalty or injury or a finding of culpability against individual public officials sued in their individual capacities, which is what my clients have been sued in, for discretionary functions, which is exactly what my clients were performing when they adopted the agenda, that you have to overcome official immunity, you've got to show actual malice, which means a deliberate intention to do wrong, and here is what that means. To constitute, this is from Murphy, to constitute the actual malice necessary to overcome official immunity, there must be the intent to cause the harm suffered by the plaintiff. And as Judge Dempsey found in April of 2021, he asked Dr. Williams specifically, what is your harm? Dr. Williams could only articulate what Justice Hodges mentioned with respect to the loss of faith and confidence. And Judge Dempsey held in his order that this was insufficient to pierce official immunity. And members of this court, I would respectfully suggest to you, there is no enumeration of error filed by the plaintiff suggesting that finding by Justice Dempsey was wrong. And I would respectfully submit they have therefore abandoned that argument. Thank you, members of the court.
Thank you so much. We gave the appellees some additional time, so if you need additional time, you are welcome to use an additional 2 minutes or so. However, if you can do it in less than the allotted time, more power to you. This is our only case today, so we're not in a big hurry or a big rush.
Thank you, Your Honors. I'd like to address a variety of points the appellees made. First, I'd like to clarify that the constitutional issue that Dr. Williams is raising on the merits, which the trial court did not address, is that the salary statute that the salary ordinance was passed with was unconstitutional. And so focusing only on his claims with regard to the salary ordinance, with regard to the DeKalb County Organizational Act, is only one of his four merits-based claims. That constitutional provision is the county home rule provision, which doesn't include an express delegation for the General Assembly to pass things like the salary ordinance to allow local county governing authorities to increase their own pay. So with that background, it doesn't make sense to say that just because the ordinance met the DeKalb County Organizational Act's requirements that all of his other claims must fail. He's raising a constitutional claim against the salary statute itself that the ordinance was passed on. And so, moving on to the Open Meetings Act claim, again, the standard that we are at is a motion for judgment of the pleadings, which is the exact same standard as a motion to dismiss, which is what the Supreme Court evaluated last time this case was before them on the board member's motion to dismiss. Dr. Williams's allegations have not changed. So any of the Supreme Court's conclusions about the applicability of immunity or just regarding his complaint generally still stand today. Nothing has changed at all with regard to his Open Meetings Act claims. And they acknowledged all of his arguments last time and said that they do state a valid Open Meetings Act claim.
Do you agree with counsel's proposition that you have to show actual malice? And if so, have you shown that?
Your Honor, at this stage
of the community.
Yes, Your Honor. At this state of the pleadings, the Supreme Court already held that Dr. Williams' allegations do show actual malice. And they concluded that here they said, we conclude that Williams' complaint sufficiently alleges that the commissioners acted with actual malice in intentionally violating the agenda requirements, a criminal act. And so they said at this stage that he sufficiently alleged that, and there's no point to dismiss his claim just on that point here. And with regard to that, the fact that the only claim is regarding the February 27th meeting is also an inaccurate characterization of what the Supreme Court held last time. It acknowledged the January 19th meeting in a listing of those Open Meetings Act violations when it held that his claims were adequately stated in his complaint. With regard to
what you're arguing and what they talked about is that you're claiming that they violated because the public wasn't given appropriate notice that they would be discussing salary at those meetings. But yet, your client, Dr. Williams, was at those meetings knowing full well that they would talk about salary, and he was there to speak against it, against the rest. So does that not kind of contradict what you're arguing?
No, Your Honor, it doesn't. And the Supreme Court did acknowledge that lack of particularized injury last time as well. Because the Open Meetings Act's intent was to prevent that harm to the public, to protect the public from closed-door politics. It's not just Dr. Williams himself, but it empowers citizens to bring these claims by including a provision for fines to make sure that citizens can bring these claims to protect the public generally. And with regard to the injury requirement on standing and the Gaddy case, Gaddy versus Georgia Department of Revenue, Gaddy was a case that involved private funds, not public funds. And taxpayer standing doctrine in Georgia says that when there is a public disbursement, the plaintiffs don't need to show particularized injury. It doesn't include private disbursements of funds. And so saying that Gaddy stands for the proposition that Dr. Williams has to show particularized injury is inaccurate because it's an opposite to this case and does not apply. And with regard to the admission of the CEO, the exact language that the Supreme Court used when it remanded that claim was, whether the allegations of Williams's complaint against the CEO Thurmond in his individual capacity show that he performs any official acts pertaining to the execution of the salary ordinance or the appropriation or the disbursement of public funds paid as salaries, however, is not clear. On remand, the CEO admitted, and this is on page 11,196-97, that he had, quote, the duty to carry out, execute, and enforce effective ordinances, including the salary ordinance. That is the admission that the Supreme Court directly asked for last time. And again, requiring an injury for taxpayer standing and requiring an injury for the Open Meetings Act is not only contrary to the rule of law in both of those scenarios, it means that no citizen could ever challenge the constitutionality of the salary statute, challenge this ordinance, or bring Open Meetings Act violations where they haven't otherwise proven unlawfulness at this stage of the pleadings, which is almost impossible to request. And so ignoring that and saying that he has to show some sort of injury is contrary to the purpose of why we have these laws. No person could ever challenge those things. And while it's remarkable that these claims are before this court, the Attorney General, with regard to the Open Meetings Act claim, already found, before Dr. Williams even filed this suit, and that this is, I believe, Exhibit N and M in the record, that these actions, these Open Meetings Act violations, these actions already amounted to Open Meetings Act violations. So this isn't something that Dr. Williams is making up as he goes along. Those were factual findings by the Attorney General.
Did they pursue criminal enforcement action, DAJ's office?
Your Honor, I see that I'm out of time. May I?
You may.
So according to the Open Meetings Act, the Attorney General's office does have the authority to pursue criminal penalties, but Dr. Williams also has authority as a citizen to bring these claims. It provides both of those as an opportunity to address and enforce the Open Meetings Act.
Right, but did the AG take any action at all on this?
We're not aware right now at the time. I do know that letter was sent right before and addressed those violations and stated that they were clear violations.
And that's in the record?
Yes, Your Honor. Exhibits M and N. If there are no further questions, I ask this court to reverse. Thank you.
Do you have any more questions?
I don't.
Any more questions?
Great job on both sides.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Yes, a very interesting argument. Thank you all for coming here in person and bringing the elements and the COVID. We're adjourned.
All right. Court of Appeals of Georgia is now adjourned. Thank you. Y'all be careful going home.
Impressive.
Thank
good to see you. Thank you.
Nice
job.
If there opportunity for a new attorney to argue. The court will consider that, of course, obviously, if it's a student arguing at that anyway, but the court is always welcome, you know, any opportunity to let the lawyers argue.
And I don't know if y'all had a chance to meet Dylan.
I did not.
But that's Dylan and Roya.
Hi.
Nice to meet you. Thank
nice
you so much.
Nice to meet you, Roya.
Thank you, Liz.
Nice to meet you. I'm the president, Mary Bennett. These are the people in my veins. I'm just a big fan. which is a lot more fun than arguing and standing up there and breaking down.
Thank you guys very much. Yeah, it's a beautiful courthouse, and my first time in here, so it was absolutely gorgeous.
Isn't that lovely?
Much better than the old place. I'm sure you guys are happy.
What was your name?
I'm Ben Clare.
What?
Ben Clare.
Okay. You look familiar.
But thank you guys very much. It's great to be down here. It's great to be back in the courtroom.
Can you see if I can tell the form? It's nice to see you in person.
Yes, thank you.
It's not Liz. Always good to see you.
Oh, you guys have a safe trip. You guys have a safe trip. Good dogs. Dr. Williams, it's good to see you. Yep.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
It's good to see you. Take care.
Good luck.